So today I'm going to have a look at a mini PC that isn't the typical stuff I look at. So it's not an Apollo Lake or an Atom mini PC, but a Fanless i7-7500U with a maximum turbo of 3.5 gigahertz. Now this comes pre-configured from Banggood. It's called the Hystou i7 and it's got 8 gigabytes of RAM and 128 gigabytes of storage. I do believe it doesn't come with an operating system installed, so that's up to the end user. So I'm going to install Windows 10 on this and test it out and review it with that. So it's about 420 US. Other specs include LAN port on there, it's gigabit Ethernet that it has, and wireless N or AC. I couldn't quite confirm what it has on there. It just says dual band, which could mean wireless N, dual band, or AC. Anyway, let's check this one out. So the box was surprisingly heavy, and it took a while to come to me. It took approximately 2.5 weeks from China to Spain. So they've included a rather large power adapter there for the plug, which will probably just be US. So the box has taken a bit of a beating, but it should be okay inside there because it's a rather bulky, chunky, heavy mini PC. Now I don't think it looks like this image because that certainly wasn't what I paid for, which should have been a black one, but we'll find out in a second. Get this open. Okay, so they've included the Hystou mouse pad for me, just in case I wanted that, a little bit of propaganda from them. We do have a driver DVD and a small little user manual. So they gave me a power adapter, but I didn't need that because look, they've already included the typical Mickey Mouse plug, and then the Euro connector, and the power supply is rather small actually, not as big as I thought it might be. So 12 volts, 5 amps is the output of that. Now there are a couple other things floating around in here. There's a SATA cable there, so if you want to hook up a 2.5 inch 1 terabyte drive or another SSD, you're able to do that. And this here is for the power for it. So there must be a power connector on the motherboard in the inside there to connect that up then to power a SATA 3 drive. This of course is a bracket. If you wanted to stand it upright, then that's the support for it. It's got some screws, that'll be for hard drive mounting, and one antenna, there should be another one in here, there it is. Stuck on the side there. So I can see that it hasn't sustained any damage, it is well protected inside that box, which is good. So on the front of the mini PC, we have a full-sized USB 2 port, an SD card reader, the power on button with a status LED to the left of it. The whole top of it's made out of aluminium. We've got these grills here, that's to help dissipate heat, because obviously the CPU is going to be up against this and dissipating all that heat through the whole housing of this. So that's a massive passive heat sink for it, because there is no fan inside this, as you'll see soon when I open it up. And the rear of the device is where we'll find all the main ports here. So we have two antenna connections there for those antennas included in the box, 3.5 millimeter audio in and out, 4 times USB 3.0 spec ports, then our gigabit Ethernet, a display port that can output 4K at 60 Hz, and then HDMI 1.4 spec that can only output 4K at 30 Hz. So if you have a 4K TV and you want to run 60 Hz, you're going to have to use an adapter. And you can get active adapters that will convert display port to 4K 60 Hz. So that's what's going to be required there. So it's a real shame that they don't include HDMI 2 spec on this, which would be perfect. So to gain access to the internals, all we need to do is remove the 3 screws either side, so 6 in total, and pull up the rear panel. Now your 2.5 inch hard drive or SSD will go here, you'd screw that on here, and there we have the SATA 3 connector for data. And then the power would come off here to plug that in to your hard drive or your SSD. So as expected, they've only used one RAM SODIMM here. So that's 8 gigabytes of RAM. And that's only going to be in single channel. So that's going to affect performance a little bit, especially when it comes to graphics performance. So I am going to actually swap that out and put in 8 gigabytes, so it's in dual channel Here we can see the wireless card and then the mSATA SSD. So both of those components can be swapped out. If you're not happy with the wireless card they've used in here, then you can of course remove that and put your own in. The same goes for the mSATA. So you can increase the capacity from 128 gigabytes up to 512, I think it is the maximum, or even a terabyte there. So you could put a Samsung Evo in. So this is the RAM I'm going to use. It's Corsair Vengeance, 2x4 gigabytes. And that means it will run in dual channel. And you can see the speed of this. This is one of those plug-in and play kits that will overclock automatically up to 2133 megahertz. Now, if that doesn't work, I'm going to have to clock it back down to something like 1866 or 1600 megahertz. So the RAM's gone in there, no problems, just clips in. It's laptop RAM, so make sure you always get the SODIMM spec double data rate 3. And I can see that the build quality of it in general, it's a good little motherboard that they've got in there. I can't see any problems with it at all. So from now on, the rest of this review is going to be captured using my screen capture card. So it did come with Windows 10 installed. I don't know whether I can trust that it's a legitimate CD key, but so far Windows Update is working. It's not saying that it's not a valid key, it's activated. And I see no signs of them using a hack or some sort of crack to activate it. So it might come with a full copy of Windows 10 Pro, but it's really hard to say because they advertise it without that. Now you see installed memory, very strange amount there. That is because I ran into problems with those two sticks that I used. It didn't like the Corsair. It wouldn't boot with that RAM at all. So I recommend just getting 1600 megahertz RAM, stick to that. Double data rate 3 low power, by the way, is the one you want to use. Now, why this strange capacity? Well, I kept the 8 that they gave me that came included, and I used one of the 4 gigabyte sticks. At least that is working for me. So that's why it's at 12 there. Now, the device manager, just wanted to point out a couple of things here. So internet, the Gigabit Ethernet controller, that's Realtek. Wireless is Broadcom N. Now, it's not a very good adapter. I'll show you in just a second. The speeds of it are quite poor. Same goes for the disk drive, the Hystou one that they've used. So their own kind of brand of SSD, and you'll see that the performance of that is quite poor. So I have run some benchmarks. This is the wireless, not very good at all. I can get out of other adapters that are using wireless N faster speeds than this. The upload's pretty slow there. So if I was going to buy this, I would try and get the bare bones model if you can, or swap out that adapter for a much better Intel wireless AC one. Then you'd be able to push a lot faster speeds through it if you're going to be streaming things like 4K. The Ethernet, of course, works just fine. That's not a problem. I can get my maximum line speeds out of that. Here's the Geekbench 4 score, which is quite good. You can see how much faster this is than the Apollo Lake or Cherry Trail Atoms. A lot faster. Those ones only get single core score. The Apollo Lake N3450 Celeron, that only gets about 1400. You can see it's almost three times as fast there. And then the multi-core score, you get around 4000 on the N3450. Here is edging towards 8000. So quite good performance from the dual core. The compute score here, another fairly decent score with the Intel HD 620 graphics. Now the internal storage, just got a couple other benchmarks to show you. Here we can see that it is quite disappointing for an SSD. I would put something like a Samsung 850 Evo in here. I mean, it's okay, those speeds, but we can get a lot better with SATA 3. It's also a shame that it doesn't have PCIe, because then you could put something like a Samsung 960 Evo in there and have some super fast SSD speeds. Another disappointment as well is the SD card slot. It's only running at USB 2 speeds, which I thought it would, because you could see that it was only plugged up to a USB 2 port there. And the AnTuTu score here, quite a good score, but still not as fast as, of course, a dedicated GPU. Now, I can talk a little bit about thermals here. After running it for a while, you can see this is 1 hour, pushing it very hard, gaming, got it up to 72 degrees, which is fine considering that this is passively cooled. As you saw in the beginning, there is no fan whatsoever. with this hardware, and I find that score to that those temperatures there to be really quite good. Now, it does get hot to the touch. I've had my thermal probe here. I'll do some more gaming and I'll keep you updated on the temperatures there. Now, this is the ninth generation, the Intel HD 620 GPU that's got on there, and it can natively handle your H.265 codecs just fine, and also VP9. Not a problem. This one here I'm going to play, this is 140 megabits per second, 4K, quite a demanding file. Now, the Apollo Lakes will struggle with this, but as you see here, it's perfectly fine. You can seek ahead, and there's no stuttering or anything. It plays this really well, very fluid. So I wouldn't be worried about using this as a media device that it's going to be able to play these files. The highest encoded really you can throw at it is going to be perfectly fine here. So I wanted to quickly demonstrate a demo here of it streaming 4K, but for some reason I'm not able to select the 4K resolution here in YouTube. I don't know what is going on. That's some bug with YouTube. Maybe they've just disabled that, and then who knows? I don't know why I cannot do that. Anyway, it will handle 4K streaming perfectly fine. You don't get any drop frames if you're using the Ethernet port, of course. But if you switch over to that wireless, it will keep up, I've found, as long as your range is good, which is why I don't recommend going with the stock wireless card. I would change that for something else. Same goes for Chrome. You can see it does drop frames now and then, but it's so much better when you're running it on this Celeron N3450, for example, the Apollo Lakes, it continually drop frames. Here, just at the beginning, it dropped a couple, and now as you can see, it's still at 8, so you can stream 4K in Chrome here. It's got the 4K setting. Something's going on with YouTube and Edge. It won't let me enable that, as I just showed you before. Let's just load in a website now. This is techtablets.com, my website, of course. And it handles this really well, super smooth, as you'd expect with that kind of performance we get on the benchmarks there with Geekbench 4. Really quick. This is what this mini PC is ideal for. So things like Office, Light, Photoshop work. You can even do video editing on this. It's not really a problem. I say 1080p is going to be fine. 4K is a little bit slow. Now, a very quick look at Kodi. So this is a media player, of course. It's very popular. Play the same file here of those jellyfish, the 4K, 140 megabit per second, 10-bit, H.265. No problems. It's very smooth. It's going to handle everything you throw at it. And you've got that space there to add another hard drive if you want it, because you've got a 2.5-inch bay there. You could screw on a 2-terabyte drive, put all your files on there. Wouldn't be a problem. And very quickly to touch on Linux here, this is Manjaro build number 17. As far as I can tell, everything is working. The wireless works, it's detecting drivers. You might have some problems with, I think, the audio. It seems to, like it's not going to work via HDMI out, or I need to configure that. But we've got, of course, drivers here that you can install. It's saying unknown device for the display, but you can see it's working fine, and performance here in Firefox. I can't see anything wrong with it. So if you wanted to use this for Linux, it looks like you are definitely in luck with this one. Okay, so we're on a busy server. Quite full, and we're getting around 50 frames per second, which is really quite decent considering that this is an integrated GPU and it's not dedicated, of course. So you can do a few games on the side here. Oh, I managed to get lucky just then though. So I think this performance is really quite good. So
So this title here is a Windows Store game, Asphalt Extreme, on the optimal, the default setting, 1080p. You can see that the performance so far is really quite good. A few little stutters, but very playable. This one's Chivalry Medieval Warfare on the lowest settings. Oh, and I died. You can see this one's got playable frame rates, but it is dipping down a little bit, which is why I'm keeping it on the lower settings, 720p. I can't mention this. And this last title here is League of Legends. It's on the Summoner's Rift map. 1080p, show you the settings, it's on high here. And as you can see, the frame rate is keeping over 60 frames per second, so really good performance. It's not gonna have any problems, the Intel HG620 playing this. Now having a look here, you can see that we don't have any thermal throttling, and it does hold a reasonably high clock rate there on the GPU, but it does dip down to about 800 megahertz, and the maximum it peaks up to is just over 1,000 there. So it did get up to 76 degrees is the maximum there I've seen it. Now I've got my thermal probe and feeling it, it is quite hot to the touch. It's 42.7 degrees right where the Hystou badge is, and touching that, yeah, very hot. But I wouldn't be worried about leaving this on continually because while it is fanless, it's dissipating that heat quite well. And as soon as you stop doing anything really demanding like gaming, you can see that those temperatures, they have dropped down now already quite quickly. And really, it's only when you're gaming is it gonna get really hot to the touch and quite warm. Okay, so just to recap here, they're positives that it's got quite a bit of power for a fanless mini PC. We've got the i7-75000U in there. It's a 2017 chip. This is the latest chip you can get. And we can configure it. We can customize it. We can put more RAM in. But that's where we run into the cons here, that they've given us a SATA 3 SSD that has very poor speeds. It's not really as fast as some other drives, for example, like the Samsung 850 Evo. And then, okay, they've given us 8 gigabytes of RAM, a single SODIMM, which is great. That means we can buy another 8 gigabytes, put that in, and run it in dual channel to get more performance out of there. But we're gonna have to spend more money. The same goes for the wireless card. It's quite a cheap wireless card, the Broadcom Wireless N, and it's only, of course, 2.4 gigahertz. The performance of it, upload speeds aren't really fast enough. If I was going to be keeping this machine, which I'm not sure I will at this point, but I will put a wireless AC, definitely mini PCI card in there, and then a Samsung 850 Evo just to increase the speed, and another 8 gigabytes of RAM. So you need to spend additional money on it. So it comes out to be a little expensive. The other thing is, if you're going to be gaming on it, do expect it to get quite hot to the touch. It'll get up to around 43 degrees, which is heading towards the hot side of things. But the temperatures are fine. There is no thermal throttling, and overall the performance is good. Now you can, of course, add another 2.5 inch drive in there. But you can add and expand upon the data. So you could put a 2 terabyte drive in there and run this as a media PC or a file storage PC, which would be great, a high performance one, as long as you connect it up, of course, with the Ethernet port and not using that slow wireless. Thanks a lot for watching this review here, and I do hope to see you back in the channel soon.